Mary Shelley's book Frankenstein is credited as being the first modern science fiction story. It's been dissected many times over the years for its complex themes: man's desire to overcome death, man's hubris dealing in God's domain, our fear of the unknown, and what it truly means to be a monster. I don't want to talk about any of that today. I want to talk about Igor. There seems to be some disagreement on how Igor is to be portrayed. He's generally deformed, moaning phrases like, "Yes, master," and being generally subservient to his mad scientist master. But sometimes he's a creation of the doctor, other times he's someone the doctor experimented on, and sometimes he's just a freak. This isn't altogether uncommon. A lot of things get manipulated as they're absorbed into the pop culture hive mind, simply because no one addresses the source material. That's why you'll see Jason depicted with a chainsaw, despite Jason never wielding a chainsaw over the course of 10 movies. But if we go back, well, there is no source material for Igor. He's an anomaly. He seems to have come into existence purely by mistake. I've always wondered how he became what he is, and what I found was a bizarre story that involved Charles Bronson, Rankin Bass, and a one-hit wonder with an excellent Boris Karloff impression. Today I address the question, where the hell did Igor come from?
The scene was rocky while we're digging the sounds. Igor on chains, backed by his baying hounds. The coffin bangers were about to arrive with their vocal group, the Crypt Kicker Five.
Let's start at the beginning. While Mary Shelley's book didn't feature any sort of lab assistant, there was a lab assistant in the play based on the book. This play, much more than the book, served as the basis for the 1931 Universal film starring Boris Karloff, which has since become the defining telling of the story. This assistant was named Fritz, although he did exemplify several very Igorish qualities. Fritz is a hunchback, he helps Frankenstein collect parts for his monster, and it's Fritz who mistakenly takes the brain of a psychopathic killer after breaking the jar of the brain he intended to steal. He would ultimately become the monster's first victim, and thus never appeared in any of the sequels to the film, though the actor, Dwight Fry, would appear in Bride of Frankenstein as Carl. This character has far fewer Igorish traits, though he does rob graves at Dr. Frankenstein's request. Fry would also play Renfield in Dracula, released the same year as the original Frankenstein. This character exhibits something resembling the traditional Igor speech patterns. He's manic, high-pitched, and frequently calls Dracula Master.
Master, we are here. You can't hear what I'm saying, but we are here.
Another hunchback assistant named Daniel would appear in the sixth Frankenstein film, House of Frankenstein. This was marketed as an ensemble film featuring Frankenstein, Dracula, and the Wolfman. What I find very interesting is the trailer for the film mentioning the hunchback among the universal monster archetypes to be featured in the film. This means that, while not quite Igor himself, the idea of an Igor character was considered essential to a Frankenstein film even back in those days. There is kind of an Igor in the original Frankenstein series. After the commercial and critical success of Frankenstein and its sequel, Bride of Frankenstein, the noticeably less good Frankenstein sequel, Son of Frankenstein, was also produced. And to build hype for the new film, Universal added one of their other horror actors, Bela Lugosi, to play the character named Igor with a Y. However, rather than being a hunchback assistant, the character was much more of an antagonist towards Henry Frankenstein's son Wolf and his mother. Igor is a mischievous blacksmith who survives a hanging. He hypnotizes the monster and uses him to exact revenge on the people who convicted him. Despite getting shot, he would return in Ghost of Frankenstein, where he gets Frankenstein's other son, Ludwig, to put his brain in the monster's body. These sequels are kinda stupid. Anyway, why Igor, like many depictions of I, Igor, is disfigured? as his near hanging leaves a scar around his neck and causes him to hunch a bit, though he's got no actual hump, just poor posture. He also has his brain inside of the monster, which I think could help with some of the confusion over whether Igor is one of Frankenstein's creations. But where did Fritz become Igor? I mean, Son and Ghost of Frankenstein aren't nearly as popular as their predecessors. This, I think, has a lot to do with the 1953 film House of Wax, starring Vincent Price as a mad wax sculptor. His assistant is named, you guessed it, Igor, this time with an I. This Igor, played by a very young Charles Bronson in one of his earliest film roles, displays a lot of characteristics Igor tends to have. He's subservient to a mad doctor, helping him in his dubious and illegal activities. He does a lot of the grunt work and, rather than being deformed, is mute. Amusing anecdote, despite playing several mad doctors over the years, Vincent Price never played Dr. Frankenstein. He did once play the monster in the pilot episode of Donnie and Marie. Anyways, I think it was around here where the wires start to cross. Frankenstein had a hunchback assistant and a character named Igor, and there's that other movie where the assistant was also named Igor. What was that? They're probably the same movie, right? There is one other aspect of Igor that needs to be addressed. His connections to acclaimed German actor Peter Lorre.
Thank you, will you have a drink with me, please?
No.
Oh, I forgot you never drink with anything. I'll have another, please.
Yes, monsieur.
You despise me, don't you?
Just so we're clear here, Lorre was never in any Frankenstein movie. He never played an Igor type at all. The closest he came was in the 1942 film The Boogeyman Will Get You, where Boris Karloff plays a mad scientist and Lorre plays a shrewd landlord. He also played the Frankenstein-inspired Dr. Einstein in Arsenic and Old Lace, which featured Karloff in the stage play, though he was recast in the film. In fact, if you really want to get into the mix, Lorre and Karloff would appear alongside House of Wax's Vincent Price in The Raven and A Comedy of Terrors, the latter of which advertised itself with the line, "Your favorite creeps together again," as if Lorre had a history in horror films despite his best-known roles being from Casablanca and The Maltese Falcon. Now, Fry's performance in Dracula could be described as very Lorre-ish, and come on. If I told you this guy was one of the creatures in Frankenstein, you'd believe me. In fact, even in the 40s when these films were fairly recent, the 1946 Looney Tunes cartoon Hair-Raising Hair would feature a mad scientist very clearly inspired by Lorre, and he would only grow more Lorre-y in his second appearance, Birth of a Notion. Which, as a side note, is a really stupid title that in no way actually ties into the cartoon. This lorifying of the Frankenstein canon would reach ahead in 1967 with Rankin Bass's Mad Monster Party, a Halloween special featuring Boris Karloff as Boris von Frankenstein. One of Frankenstein's creations is a creepy butler named Yecht, played by Alan Swift. The character is, both in voice and design, based on Lorre.
I wish Dr. Frankenstein hadn't grounded me. Someday I hope he'll let me fly again.
I think it is equally possible that Rankin Bass did this as an intentional homage to the Looney Tunes, or merely because they misremembered and didn't realize Peter Lorre never appeared in a Frankenstein film. Whichever way it is, this film gave a very Igor-like character a few features he's known for, namely his Peter Lorre-ness and the idea of him being a creation of Frankenstein. And then, just to add even more confusion, in the sequel film, Mad 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 Monsters, there's a surprisingly similar character, again voiced by Alan Swift, named Igor. This idea of Igor would be repeatedly reinforced through the late 50s and early 60s. In line with the 20-year cycle of pop culture, Universal Monsters became something of a nostalgic kitsch in this era. It was the decade of the monsters and Hammer horror. Bobby Boris Pickett, the man who wrote the Monster Mash, I think had a huge hand in the influence of the character. Of course, his most famous song mentions Igor by name, but on his album, The Original Monster Mash, he has a song titled Irresistible Igor, about a hunchback grave robber porking Frankenstein's wife.
Each night he robs a different grave, another heart he ends. Last night the bride of Frankenstein,
by the early 70s, lab assistants named Igor appeared in a number of sketch comedy shows, including The Electric Company and an obscure little show called The Hilarious House of Frankenstein. This show is hilariously awkward, and I love it. But all of that is fairly innocuous. I mean, how much of that would you have known about if I hadn't mentioned it? A Rankin Bass TV movie, an album from the Monster Mash guy, some Canadian kids show? Igor could divorce himself from those depictions. It would take a much more popular parody to put the final nail in Igor's coffin.
No, it's pronounced Igor.
Enter Young Frankenstein. Young Frankenstein was not only a very popular movie, but also a very accurate one. This is a more accurate Frankenstein sequel than a lot of the official Frankenstein sequels. And yet here, we don't have Fritz or Carl or even Renfield, we have Igor. And they make jokes about his character. They endear the idea of Igor to the masses. And what's bizarre about this Igor, too, is that he claims to be the grandson of the original Igor who helped Dr. Frankenstein. This is why the myth of Igor has persisted so long. He came to be through simple misremembering, but he stays alive because of revisionist history. There was no Fritz, no Carl, no Renfield, there was only Igor. You might say that sounds like a bit too much, but I would like to present this piece of evidence. A Frankenstein lunchbox from 1979, licensed by Universal themselves. Who's this in the corner? Is it Fritz? No, in plain text, Igor. These are the very people you would expect to know Igor doesn't exist, but at this point, Igor was so associated with the Frankenstein myth, no one would even know who Fritz was. And so it has been. Igor has just seeped into the general conscience of pop culture, to the point where the most recent adaptation of the story, Victor Frankenstein from 2016, became the first non-comedic adaptation of the Frankenstein story to feature Igor. This, Daniel Radcliffe, is the closest thing to an official Igor. But he sure is prevalent in other media. There was a movie all about the idea of being Igor in 2008. Frankenstein is a story that can teach us a lot about human nature, but it took the story of Igor to teach us about the nature of pop culture, of how we remember the past. Igor is a spook. He never existed. But according to the general public, to even the most dedicated imitators, and even to the very people who originated the story he's supposed to be in, he's integral to any adaptation. Why, Mr. Igor, you've always been here.
Irresistible Igor, how dashing is he, in his nightly body snatching, Yelena holds the key to the hearts of female zombies. They love him one and all. They see him stealing through the night, and one by one they fall. Irresistible Igor, I wonder what he's got. Can't be his twisted body, and his face is gone to pot. But irresistible Igor,